यस
So today we are going to discuss about different types of fermenters which are used for different type of functions. They are either batch type or fed batch type and continuous type of fermenters people are using for different purposes in different type of industries. We have already studied a lot about different kind of fermentation processes. We have already discussed about submerged culture method, then solid state fermentation, what is fermentation, and how we can use in it in dairy industry, and what are the different products prepared by using different kind of fermentation process. So today we will discuss about different types of fermenters, its functions, design and control, then sterilization and growth rate analysis of different type of fermenters. So we have already discussed about the fermentation. It is a process in which a substance breaks down into a simpler substance using organisms. We are selecting a particular type of microorganism or a group of microorganisms for achieving certain type of end product. And in our dairy industry, you people have already idea that for preparation of different kind of fermented dairy product, we are deliberately choosing a particular type of microbe. And after incubation, we will have to incubate it at a optimum growth temperature for that particular microorganism. And after certain period of incubation, certain characteristic will be changed of that product. And ultimately, a desired final product will be prepared, having a typical type of flavor, taste, texture, or some kind of substance are also produced, which are helpful in giving shape to your final product. And at the same time, it will improve the shelf life of that particular product. So if you talk in biochemical terms, the meaning of fermentation relates to the generation of energy by the catabolism of organic compounds. We have already discussed about all these things. So today we will discuss that what are the different components of a particular or a good type of fermenter, and what are the special things in it. So bioreactor or fermenter is a device or a system in which a chemical process is carrying out that supports to maintain a biological active environment inside that vessel, which involves organisms or biochemically active substances derived from a specific organism. So what is happening in this? A particular type of vessel is there, and different kind of fittings and mountings are there. There is, you can see in right side of this slide, feeding pump is there through which you can take feeding material or whatever substance you have to use for fermentation process. Then the air inlet system is there. Aerator is fitted in the bottom of that vessel. Then it is a thermal jacket. And there are different kind of sensor probes are also fitted inside that chamber. And just by fitting that, just by observing these sensors, we can have idea about the pH level, temperature level, and concentration level of different component. So, and on the top, agitation system is there through which you can rotate impeller inside the vessel, fermenter vessel. And the process which is used for fermentation, they are either aerobic or anaerobic in nature. These bioreactors are commonly cylindrical in shape, ranging in size from liters to cubic meters, and are often made up of stainless steel material. I have already explained the different fittings or different mounting or accessories of a typical or a good type of fermenter in our in my last class. So fermentation system or processes objectives depends upon the two factors, that is fermenter design and fermentation process. So what kind of fermentation is required and what type of process you have to choose, it all depends upon the end product you want to produce. So depending upon that, you can select a particular type of size. So we have idea that fermentation process is known to mankind for thousands of years, but has been mainly based on the glucose found in various fruits, seeds and tubers into alcohol. And nowadays, it is very frequently used in our daily life. People have started consuming different type of alcoholic product. Then, if you talk about the recent times, different kind of fermenter, which are used in different industry, they simply provide an optimal environment for bacteria or fungi to grow inside the vessel, and the cultivation of said organisms will yield a desirable substance. As all of you know, that we are selecting a particular type of microbe, and at the same time, we are formulating a typical type of substrate for growing that particular microorganism. And just by combining these things and giving a certain environmental condition inside the fermenter or vessel, you can get a desirable end product which you want to produce. So organisms growing in bioreactors may be submerged in liquid medium or may be attached to the surface of the solid medium. We have already discussed a lot about the solid state fermentation as well as the liquid or submerged fermentation. In case of continuously operated process, the organism will be removed from the reactor with the effluent. But in some cases where batch method is used, we are not adding or taking out the final product from the system. Now something about the immobilization process. It is a general term describing a wide variety of methods for sale or particle attachment or entrapment. It can be applied to basically all types of biocatalysts, including enzymes, cellular organelles, animal and plant cells. So immobilization is useful for continuously operated processes, since the organism will not be removed with the reactor effluent, but it is limited scale because of the microbe are only present on the surface of the vessel. So what is special in it? In continuous process, we have to maintain a typical condition. We are adding some amount of substrate from outside, and at the same speed, we are taking out the final fermented product. So the whole process of addition of some kind of substrate, utilizing proper utilization of the different kind of microorganisms used in the system, and the whole system undergoes, and you can tell the whole process is immobilization of the system. So something about the typical parts which are present in bioreactor. The first and most important thing is agitator. It is generally used for mixing of the content of the reactor, which keeps the cells in the perfect homogeneous condition for better transport of nutrient and oxygen to the desired product. Because every time you have to maintain a special condition inside the chamber. You have to supply oxygen. You have to add some amount of nutrients inside the system. So for proper mixing of the content present in the system, a good quality agitator should be there, and it is fitted on the top with some kind of reducing gear. So the next is baffle. It is used to break the vortex formation in the vessel, which is usually highly desirable as it changes the center of gravity of the system and consume additional power. So it is also a very, baffle is also very important. Then spargar, in aerobic cultivation process, the purpose of spargar is to supply adequate oxygen to the growing cell. In some fermenter, you will see that it is fitted in the bottom portion just to add some amount of oxygen inside the chamber. Now the jacket, the whole fermenter body, the jacket provides the annular area for circulation of constant temperature of water, which keeps the temperature of the bioreactor at a constant value. So double jacketed system is there, and you have to maintain a particular temperature throughout, or you can say whatever temperature required for the fermentation process, you have to maintain that level inside the chamber. So for that, proper jacket or proper system should be there in the fermenter. Now, something about the batch as well as continuous fermentation process. Here in table, I have given you a difference between these two. In batch process, bacteria are inoculated into the bioreactor. Always tired tank or bioreactor is used in this. Then under certain condition, temperature, pH, aeration, the bacteria will grow inside the system. And though through all the growth phases, lag phases, or exponential phases, then stationary phases, you have idea about the different growth phases. So we will discuss it in our today's class. So, now something about the advantages of batch method. It can be used for different reactions every day. It is safe, little risk of infection or a strain mutation is there, complete conversion of substrate into the final product. So these are the advantages, because we are not taking out any kind of end product from the system. And at the same time, we are not adding any extraneous matter inside the system. So there will be more control in this type of batch process. And these are the advantages. And some advantages are also there. High labor cost, much ideal time is required. Then safety, filling, emptying, cleaning. So automatically, there may be chances of some contamination, ultimately it will create some kind of abnormal condition to the final product. Now in continuous process, the fresh medium flows into the fermenter continuously. And part of the medium in the reactor is withdrawn from the fermenter at the same flow rate of the inlet flow. I have already told you people that what is the difference between batch and continuous. We are taking a particular type of substrate. We are deliberately choosing a particular type of microorganism for achieving desired kind of fermentation. But what is special in continuous process? We are adding some amount of medium inside the reactor, and at the same time, we are taking out some amount of final fermented product from the system. Bacteria is grown under certain condition, temperature, pH, aeration. You have already idea about all these, how you can maintain this thing inside the chamber. There are different type of sensors are fitted in fermenter. Now some advantages is given here. It works all the time, low labor cost, good utilization of the reactor, then often efficient process due to the autocatalytic nature of microbial reaction. It is better than the batch process. Then automation may be very appealing. Constant product quality will be prepared when you are using this kind of continuous process. But some disadvantage is also there in this. And the main, it promises continuous process for months fails due to the infection, spontaneous mutation of microorganisms to non-producing strain. So what is happening? Sometimes you will get some kind of mutation in your culture which you are using for achieving desired fermentation, because it is a long process and there may be chances of some kind of infection also. So if such problems arises in the system, automatically it will restrict or it will inhibit the production of your end product. So batch cultivation process, it is a closed system where there is no interaction between the system and the surrounding during the process. But sometimes we are using some amount of air where some kind of aerobic cultivation is required. Then in batch cultivation, we prepare medium, slice it, and inoculate the culture into the bioreactor. And thereafter, it will be allowed to grow and produce whatever microbe are there, that will be allowed to grow and produce the final end product. And once the product formation reaches to the maximum, at the same time, we have to close the system and we have to start harvesting of the final product. Now, something about the sales growth during cultivation process. You all have idea about the microbial growth, how it is growing in any medium. There is lag phase, accelerated growth phase is there. Then exponential growth phase is there. Then decline phase is there. Then stationary phase, death phase is there. And how it is utilizing, how any bacteria utilizes, and when its multiplication take place. These all have already taught to you people in previous classes. But again, I am briefing about all these things. First of all, I am describing this lag phase. Lag phase is an initial period of cultivation during which the change of cell number is zero or negligible. And the cell number does not increase. The cells may grow in size during this period. And the lag phase results from several factors. What is happening actually inside the system? When cells are placed in the fresh medium, the intracellular concentration of cofactors, amino acids, ions will decrease, and these have to synthesize, transported first before cell division to occur. And when the cells are inoculated in the system, or you can say in the medium containing different carbon sources, then the enzymes for its metabolism have to be transported. So what kind of enzyme is there, what kind of substrate is there, it all depends upon the it all influence or regulate the lag phases. So what is generally happening? If some glucose is present in the system, automatically it will take less time. And if some other complex carbohydrate present in the system, it will take longer period. So the same thing is in milk. Whatever glucose present in the system, the first of all, those glucose will be utilized. And for utilization of lactose, which is our main carbohydrate, the system has to produce beta-galactosidase, which is very essential, and a separate pathway is there for utilizing or for converting these lactose into the final product. Now, how to avoid lag phase? Lag phase is non-productive period in the industrial fermentation. Hence, industrial fermentation minimizing it is essential. So we should reduce the lag phase period. Size of inoculum is very important. If the size of inoculum is large, then the lag phase can be minimized. So just you have to increase the total inoculum level. The stage of culture from where the stage of from where the inoculum is drawn is very important. If you are taking your culture or your seeding material which is already in logarithmic phase, automatically it will take less time or you can reduce the lag phase time period. Now the accelerated growth phase, at the end of lag, when growth begins, the division rate increases gradually and reaches a maximum value. The growth rate increases to maximum during this accelerated growth phase. Now, one of the most important step is exponential growth phase. That is, during this period, cell division occurs in this phase. Often cell dry weight is used for knowing or having idea about the cell concentration. Now, stationary phase. This is also very important. In this phase, the growth, that is cell division, almost ceases due to the exhaustion of nutrients. Whatever nutrients are there in the system, that is already utilized by the microorganisms in the system. And at the same time, there may be a accumulation of toxic product in the system. At this stage, the cell death starts at a slow rate and is compensated by the formation of new cell through cell division. So it is very important to have complete idea about different phases. And that is very important to select a particular type of fermentation processes for producing a particular type of end product. Now, decline phases. In the phase of decline, the total number of cells remains constant, but the number of viable cells gradually decreases due to exhaustion of nutrients and also the accumulation of toxic products. In some cases, a few cells remain viable for a long time, even after death of most of the other cells present in the system. These viable cells probably grow by utilizing nutrients releasing from the death cell. So whatever death occurred, that and whatever the nutrients present in that cells releases, that will be further utilized by other microorganisms present in the system. Now, something about the criteria or need to be satisfied for the material to be treated as medium in industrial level. It should give maximum yield of the product. It should give minimum yield of the undesired product and considerably available throughout the year, and it should be cheap. So this is all about the substrate. And at the same time, it is important that what kind of microorganism is required for a typical fermentation process. So whatever microbe we are selecting, that must grow in the growth medium or substrate you are using in that substrate medium. And at the same time, it should satisfy the nutritional needs. The substrate you are using, that should satisfy the needs of microorganisms. Now, the complete analysis is needed to be done to establish the most favorable medium for the growth of microorganisms used in the fermentation process. Because compatibility is very important. Whenever you are selecting a particular type of microorganism, at the same time, you have to select a compatible substrate. And that substrate must be a combination of water, source of energy, carbon, nitrogen, mineral elements, and different kind of vitamins which favors the growth and activity of selected microorganisms. In most of the cases, we are using submerged culture method, but in certain cases, we have to select solid substrate fermentation process. So depending upon the type and the product you are going to prepare and the changes you want to achieve or produce in a particular type, you have to select a particular type of fermentation process. Now, we are mainly focused today on batch culture and continuous culture. What is special in batch culture? It is generally performed in a closed system of cultivation. In this technique, first of all, what we are doing, first nutrient solution is prepared and it is inoculated with inoculum. Whatever culture organism you have selected for achieving or for performing the task, you have to prepare that. And nothing is added in the fermentation tank except aeration. We have already discussed about all these things. Since fresh media is not adding during the course of incubation, concentration of nutrition decreases continuously. Furthermore, various types of toxic metabolites also produce in the system and finally accumulates in culture vessel. Therefore, batch culture technique gives characteristic growth curve with lag phase, log phase, stationary phase, and decline phase. Some advantages of this phase: chances of contamination of culture is minimum in batch culture. I have already told you that we are not adding anything from outside, and we are not taking out anything from the system. So automatically, the chances of contamination is less. And one very important disadvantage is it gives low product yield, and it is not economic procedure. Now, the second most important method, that is fed batch culture technique. What is special in it? Fed batch culture is also called as semi-closed system of cultivation. And in this, first nutrient media is prepared and it is inoculated with culture organism and then incubated for a particular period. Then during the course of incubation, a particular nutrient is added at intervals without removing the used up media. So the volume of culture increases continuously. So what is the special in fed batch culture and how it is different from the batch culture? Here, at the start of fermentation process, you are not taking the whole amount of substrate or whole amount of media. You are taking a small amount and you are adding culture inside that. And after fermentation of that amount of substrate, you have to add some amount of media after certain interval. It is generally done because if you add whole substrate at the start of fermentation process, it will inhibit the growth activity of different kind of starter bacteria. So you have to keep this thing in your mind that this is the particular difference between fed batch and batch fermentation method. Now, something about advantages. Fed batch culture gives greater product yield than batch culture technique. Then, and one disadvantage is there, chance of contamination of culture is higher in fed batch than batch culture technique because you are adding substrate inside the system. Initially, you are taking a small amount of substrate, and after complete fermentation of initial substrate, you are adding some amount of substrate for the continuation of that process. Now, the third one is the most important method, that is continuous culture method. And industrially, people are preferring this method for producing large amount of fermented product. So in this method, it is also called as open system of cultivation. What is happening in that? Fresh sterile medium is added continuously in the vessel, and use of media with bacterial culture is removed continuously at the same rates. And whatever volume is there in the system, we have to keep constant level inside the cultivation vessel. That is very important. And what is special is there in this technique, bacteria grow continuously in the log phase. And this type of growth is known as steady state growth. It is very important that, and the cell density in continuous culture remain constant, and it is achieved by maintaining constant dilution and flow rate. And this continuous culture method is important in industrial processes that harvest the primary metabolites of microorganisms as their product. Primary metabolites are produced in greatest quantities when the organisms are growing at their fastest rate. Now, how many different type of continuous culture method are used? So here mainly in an industry, people are using chemostat method and turbidostat method. But we will discuss about these methods in our next class. But something about the advantage of continuous method: it can be carried out in a smaller vessel. Productivity is very high when you are using a smaller vessels for fermentation process. The high productivity for biomass and intra and extracellular enzymes are more cost effective. So When you are using any sort of continuous culture method for manufacturing of any kind of product, automatically it is more cost effective and higher amount of product you can produce by using this particular method. Now, something about the disadvantages of continuous method: microbial growth, clumping of cells and foaming tends to block up inlet pipes, can be difficult to control. All the environmental factors could lead to the considerable amount of waste. And at the same time, it is not possible to create the low nutrients, high stress condition under which secondary metabolites such as penicillin are produced. So this is the advantage of continuous culture method. And here I have given you a photograph of batch culture as well as continuous culture. In batch culture, we can maintain a very controlled environment. And at the same time, in continuous culture method, we are regularly and we are continuously removing the final fermented product from the fermenter. And at the same time, we are adding the same amount of substrate inside the chamber. So, this is all about the batch and continuous method of fermentation process. And in the next class, we will discuss about the different type of method. Like in the last slide, I have told you that chemostat and turbidostat, how it is functioning, how we can maintain a better control in these two methods, what are the specificity of these two methods. So this is all about the batch culture, fed batch culture, and continuous culture method. Thank you. Thanks a lot.